morning once again, and thank you, Dr. Sonal, for inviting me to this course to give this talk. So this will be like discussion of various experiences or cases which probably were misdiagnosed or overdiagnosed during a clinical examination. So probably this talk also reminds me when I took ophthalmology, I was like, okay, ophthalmology, eye is there, I'll like just finish it like anything. Nothing is there. Once I entered into ophthalmology, and then I was like, the depth of ophthalmology is so much, you cannot kind of, you know, confine it. The same way, starting with conjunctivitis, we came across eye flu from our school time, eye flu. Then how this conjunctivitis at time poses challenge. So we'll be coming across some of the case scenarios which may be very simple and sometimes very atypical. So coming to our first case, which was of a 29-year-old female who presented with discomfort, pain, redness, discharge, went to a very famous local ophthalmologist, examined there, and was advised, diagnosed as viral conjunctivitis, and advised topical lubricant eye drops, oral non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, asked to come after 1 week. So the patient was not kind of relieved with the symptoms, went for another consult to another doctor. The doctor saw the prescription, made another diagnosis, added an antibiotic, and diagnosed as bacterial conjunctivitis, so the same treatment along with added topical antibiotic. Patient again, not relieved, come back for a third consult. Third consult, what it was a case of anterior uveitis, which was not properly examined. So I took 5 minutes from the patient, spoke to that patient, what actually happened on the first visit. The first visit, patient was not examined on this slit lamp. Seen, asked for symptoms, and at times you see the patients are also, they feel like you ask, there is pain, yes, pain is there. Discomfort, yes. Redness, yes. Discharge, patient feels the more I tell, the better I get treated. So that was the thing. The first patient, the first visit, he was not examined on the slit lamp. The second visit, the doctor took the prescription rather than examining the patient first on the slit lamp. That is also one of the mistakes which is commonly done, especially for the young ophthalmologists who are there. First, do your own examination, then see the previous or prescriptions or medicines. So the patient was managed, was a fairly simple case, but went through 3 consultations, just the first episode of anterior uveitis. So coming to the second case, so this was a 24-year-old male student, which was a hostel inmate, presented with discomfort, redness, itching, and on examination of the lashes, you see these cylindrical deposits, which appeared to be like blepharitis, but on course examination, you see they are cylindrical egg-like deposits. Some of them are hatched, you see holes over here, and some of them are intact. So now these are those cases which you not commonly see. So then I went through a kind of Google search in the clinic itself and resembled it like a case of nits. Nits, then I started looking for the culprits. So culprits in this nits is the crab louse. So I'll just play a video here. So there you see, at the base of the lid margin, nicely seated is the crab louse. So this was a video which was made on the slit lamp with my cell phone itself. And the eggs are there. So this patient had constant complaint of itching, irritation, and was treated with the lubricants and antibiotics. I'm trying to remove this louse manually and see how tenaciously they are holding the lash. The entire lids come down and the louse still it's holding the lash. So mechanically, I removed all these louse from the lid margins as well as the eggs. And diagnosis was obviously thyriasis palpebrum blepharo conjunctivitis. The management has what it was available at the to my local nearby pharmacy shop. I did mechanical removal, petroleum jelly, permethrin shampoo, advised the importance of personal hygiene, and gave us to consult a dermatologist. So a little bit of discussion about this. So 3 types of louse are there in the body louse, head louse, and the pubic louse. And strangely, the louse which are closer to the eye, they do not infect the lashes. It is the pubic louse which actually infects commonly the lashes. So thyriasis palpebrum is uncommon cause of blepharoconjunctivitis and is easily misdiagnosed. There are other variable management options. So whatever is available at your local pharmacy or nearby shops, you can opt for that. So none of them are 100% ovicidal. So manual removal of these nits and louse and along with any of those ovicidal agents is recommended. So coming to the third case, the third case was a 27-year-old male who had redness, discharge, foreign body sensation, irritation, and excessive discomfort in the morning. Now, again, examining on the lid margins, you see at the margins the cylindrical dandruff-like deposits at the lash bases, eyelash base. So a bit magnified, you see this again. These are unusual presentations, and this was a case which was diagnosed as Demodex blepharitis. So management again was done with tea tree oil, soap, and shampoo, lid scrub with 50% tea tree oil, lid massage with 5% tea tree oil, lid hygiene, and again a dermatologist's opinion. These are the cases which don't respond to conventional treatment, and then they indicate you to look for something else. So importance of examining the adnexa is very important in these cases. Now discussion, coming to discussion of this, these are the smallest arthropods with which is Demodex follicularum and Demodex brevis. Two species are there. Follicularum, as the name suggests, is attached to the follicle, lash follicle, and is 0.3 to 0.4 mm in length, and the brevis burrows inside the pilosebaceous unit in the sebaceous and meibomian glands, is 0.15 to 0.2 mm in length. Infestation is high in 20 to 30 years of age group when the sebum secretion rate is at its highest. So this is the diagram where you see Demodex follicularum, which is attached to the nearby to the follicles, and these are the brevis which burrow inside. And cause, these are also causes of meibomian gland dysfunction. So again, a follicle attached with this Demodex follicularum, hair follicle seen under a microscope. So again, what is the confirmatory microscopic examination is also one of the confirmatory tests. These mites are normally also present on the human skin, but when pathological infestation takes place, when their quantity increases, when they kind of multiply too much in excess. So high index of suspicion is there when blepharitis, conjunctivitis, or blepharoconjunctivitis in adult or recurrent chalazion in young patients and refractory to conventional treatments. So when there is madrosis or recurrent trichiosis, you have to think of these things. Coming to the fourth case, this was a 48-year-old female who presented with discomfort, redness, discharge, both eyes, burning sensation, foreign body sensation. So I averted the lid margin. You see upper tarsal conjunctiva, which was red, velvety, and inflamed. And there, a diagnosis of superior limbic conjunctivitis was made. You see this aspect also, the superior conjunctiva was more congested. So etiology, again, superior limbic conjunctivitis, keratoconjunctivitis, secondary to superior bulbar conjunctival laxity, which induces inflammatory changes from mechanical soft tissue microtrauma. Other risk factors can be prolonged eyelid closure with associated hypoxia or reduced tear volume, and also to, at times, functional changes in conjunctival apposition to the globe following upper eyelid procedures. Again, it's more common in females, and symptoms may remit and exacerbate, may be variable in degree. And patients with corneal, at times corneal filaments are very, very symptomatic, and they distract you from examination. SLK may be associated with thyroid dysfunction, keratoconjunctivitis sicca, and rheumatoid arthritis. Management, there are various management options like patching, BCL, topical vitamin A, even topical cyclosporine drops, mast cell stabilizers, tacrolimus ointments, autolygous serum drops. But the best treatment is surgical resection of the redundant bulbar conjunctiva. Now coming to a final case, which says, as the name suggests, to do or not to do and when to do. So this is a 22-year-old male who came for opinion about LASIK and had a few haziness and history of red eye month back. This was the presentation. 1 month back, wanted to come for LASIK opinion. So you might be getting patients like these for cataract surgery or refractive surgery. And then the dilemma comes, what to do? So I asked this patient, who was a patient for refractive surgery, I asked, defer the surgery, put him on topical steroids. Now, putting on topical steroids increases the infective period. So coupled with povidone iodine, so that infectivity decreases, asked him to come back after a couple of months. So I use generally low-dose topical steroid. And then this was the case. Now there are other agents also for them. So refractive surgery in these kinds of cases, if they clear also, the antigen is still lying there. And per se, clearance of these infiltrates doesn't kind of ensure you that this won't recur. This can recur, as told by Randall Ben et al. This was a case which was reported in 2004. Even after like clearing this record. So it won't ensure you that these infiltrates won't recur in the future. So that you have to take a call, you have to wait, probably you can wait for the recurrence. There is no specific timeline for how long you have to wait. And if you take a same scenario of a cataract surgery, I feel like after waiting for some time, you can go ahead with the cataract. After cataract, again, you will put steroid drops. That will take care.
Actually, just I wanted to, okay, that is your.
So finally, take home my message is the conjunctiva is just a mucous membrane which gives signs for ocular pathologies which may be underlying, overlying, or lying within. Hence, its infection or injection always indicates a thorough ocular examination. Can we just